بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين وخاتم النبيين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. It is a great honor to be amongst you here tonight in the city of Birmingham. Came a long way from Auckland, New Zealand. It's about 28-29 continuous flight, but no, there was indeed some transit time, but the total hours of flying is about 28 hours from Auckland to Birmingham. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you quite well, and the organizers. May Allah reward you for coming, and organizers for organizing that event. At the beginning, would like to just remind myself and all of the people here that to go through tests or to go through hardships is something which is quite normal. Not only to Muslims, but to non-Muslims as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لَقَدَ خَلَقَنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدٍ. It is a highlight that all insan, all the human being have been created in kabad, kabad, hardship. You know, we haven't been created here to live in the paradise. We have been created here to achieve specific goals and aims. And then there is another life which is eternal, where we are going to dwell in. There is a very important principle as well we need to just take care of at the beginning of this topic. Allah says in the Quran, وَنَبْلُوَكُمْ بِالْخَيْرِ وَالشَّرِّ فِتْنَةً. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that He would test us with good and bad stuff. Usually when we say trials, what comes to my mind and yours is bad stuff, crisis, musibah. But it doesn't mean that we should only be trialed through bad stuff or through difficulty or through hardship. We could be trials with good stuff or what is considered as good by majority of the people, such as money. Money, everybody would love to have money, but money could be actually a way for us to get closer of Allah, to Allah, or it could be a mean for us to stay away from Allah or keep away from Allah. So who decides this? It's our own actions and our own will. If we haven't had a will, Allah would never set us for accountability in this life nor in the hereafter. Because simply you could come in the day of Qiyamah and say, Ya Allah, I didn't have will, so I'm not responsible for my own deeds. But we have had will. We do have will in this life, and that's why we are accountable in the day of Qiyamah. To look at the tests and trials, we need first to appreciate what we have here in this life. We have many things we don't pay for. From the first moment in the morning, you open your eyes, you get outside, and you're enjoying the sun. You're not enjoying the sun that much here in the UK, are you? I left New Zealand, well, it was spring, so maybe I'm talking about my experience rather than yours. Anyway, the sun is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how many of us actually think about this fact every day in the morning? How many? Imagine if we don't get the sun shining over our planet for a year. Do you think that we would be able to maintain life here? For how long are we going to be able to maintain it? So this is a great gift of Allah. Let aside the fresh air we are inhaling and exhaling. You know, we inhaling and exhaling 16 times, at least 16 times every minute. Imagine if a big power in the world is in control of the oxygen. Ya Allah, to get your oxygen every day, you have to pay £50 or £100. How many of people of our human race would be able to be alive? If you don't have £100 a day, you can't get your own enough of oxygen to live with. Do we actually think about, appreciate those gifts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Bounties. Allah says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. To understand trials, we need to appreciate gifts. How many gifts Allah has given me and you? You know, my sheikh back home is blind. He's a professor at Al-Azhar University. Blind since he was 12 years old. But he was able to carry on his studies. He was able to be among the first people at uni, at the high school and uni. He was able to be a professor at a very prestigious university. He's fluent in his own language, Arabic and English as well. But he's blind. Imagine you are blind. May Allah give you a good health and wealth. But imagine that you are blind for a day. How are you going to go through your day? Well, Dr. Lashin is very normal. He gets in the morning after doing his salat. Gets in the morning, he dress up, he goes out by himself with his own stick, and he just take his way to the bus station. Yeah? And he takes the bus to the downtown where the university is. Some people who are able to see like me and you went to him and they gave me a call and said that, how does he do this? They live in the same country. How does he do this? He wakes up in the morning, he walks. You know, it's not like England here, okay? Egypt is not like the UK. You don't have that very nice pavement or footpath where you walk on and it goes down and then it goes up smoothly and nicely. No, it's our pavement is a bit high. So if you fall down, it could be the end of your life. Maybe it was designed for us in that way to get rid of our big number so the country would maintain a good life for us. This has been done since a long time ago. One day I went to visit him and I saw a big reddish area next to his right eye. I said, what is that, my ustaz? I said, what is that? He said, no, don't worry. I just fall down and it seemed that the ground has given me a nice kiss here. He was actually taking things easy. But one day I saw him and he told me that he was frustrated because he brought some books. And books is actually his life. And he wasn't able to find actually the books, the bag. And he tried to find the bag of the books, but he wasn't. It seemed that someone took it and put it somewhere else. So he spent the hours. Imagine if it is you, you can find that bag in 10 seconds, a minute, 5 minutes. He spent hours to get to this bag, but he wasn't able to. Was very frustrated. Do we appreciate Allah's gift as sight? Do we appreciate that? How many of us would actually worry about tomorrow's breakfast? Do I have anyone in the hall here who has got any problem, who's not able to manage or to have a breakfast for the kids tomorrow? Anyone? No? You are among the richest people in the whole wide world. Many people are not sure whether they are going to have breakfast tomorrow or not. They don't have food. Some people used to be like you and me. But due to war and problems, they cannot actually guarantee whether they're going to have a breakfast tomorrow or not. When we were in Jordan, we have visited Jordan. We visited the Syrian refugees. When we went to inside one of the houses, we found one of the aunties. And she had actually a cupboard. When we opened it, there was only some plates. And next to it, there was a very tiny small table. On the top, there was za'atar, thyme, some thyme, and maybe some bread. No, there was no bread, only thyme. Was that the food for lunch? Some, not too much. And we're talking about a family of someone who lost her own husband, but she had her son, another son-in-law, a daughter, another daughter, two kids, 7 people. 7 people. Alhamdulillah. So how many gifts Allah has given us? How many gifts Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us? If we go back and we find a lot of stuff in our house, alhamdulillah. We have healthy kids, alhamdulillah. We have good health, alhamdulillah. But even those who struggles in their life and able to say alhamdulillah, they are the people who are enjoying happiness in this life. You know, when I saw that man in one of the Jordan's house from Syria originally, from Homs, and I said, uncle, old man with his wife, 3 sisters, and four grandchildren, 3 and 3 daughters. And his daughter-in-law lost sight in the left eye, and he lost his son. His son was killed. And he had himself a disability, right? He had a disability, and he was sitting. I said, how are you? He said, alhamdulillah. I said, oh my God. Subhanallah. All of those trials he went through, but he still says, alhamdulillah. He appreciates what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. And that was a good opportunity for me to reflect. Do I say alhamdulillah from the bottom of my heart, or do I say it in a routine way just as it is, or it became a habit? Do I say it and I feel satisfied with Allah? Am I satisfied with Allah? Do I appreciate what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me? Do I appreciate what Allah has given me? Allah has given me a lot of gifts, even before I come to this real world. In the womb of my mom, in the womb of your mom, do you complain about the sitting? Can you compare this to any bed in the world? No one can compare that beautiful place to any bed in the world. That place has been made especially for us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not only that, but we have had a secure source of food through a tube from our mom into our own tummy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared this in advance for us. And once we are delivered outside, we come out to this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without us asking Him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us beautiful and warm and nice milk in the winter, fresh and cool in the summer, from the breasts of our own moms. Have you ever asked for this before you come? Can't you trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as you trusted Him before? Before you had no ability to even talk to Him? You need to always trust Him, because even before, remember, and still now and in the future, without asking, He is giving you. So why would He let you down? Even though you are struggling, remember that He is next to you and He's by you and He's going to support you. Have you ever asked Him to grow teeth for you so you can eat once you became 2 years old? Nobody asked, but Allah has grown those teeth for us in the right time. A chick, when a chick is born, that chick is stronger than us. A chick in few minutes, no, could be few seconds, can stand up and move. But how long do we need to stand up and walk? How long does that take us? But Allah has taken care of us, hasn't He? When you feel very bad, remember that Allah, in many situations, got you through some difficult times. Trust Him that, and ask yourself, why wouldn't Allah get me through that tough and difficulty this time? Why? You know, when a trial occurs, you need to thank Allah for five things. Because five things, hopefully, as long as five things took place. Now, the first one, that the problem you are going through is not in your deen. I.e., you've been praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You stopped praying. Astaghfirullah. Big musibah, big crisis. As long as the trial or the test is not in your deen, you are fine. You're wearing the hijab. And then you give up wearing al-hijab. This is a trial. This is a crisis. But a crisis in your own deen. A crisis in your own deen. So as long as the crisis is not in your deen, what do you say? Alhamdulillah. It's good that the crisis is not in my deen. Like Sayyidina Muhammad says, Allahumma la taj'al musibatana fi dinina. Don't make my musibah. The crisis occurs to me, Allah, in my deen. Sometimes you have a crash, you have some problem. I had a crash the year 2000 before I have my elder daughter. And someone said, that, how come you are a sheikh and you have had a crash? It's not a good sign. I said, oh, okay. So if someone is an imam or a sheikh or religious person, he should be safe and sound all the time. He said, yeah. I said, well, Sayyidina Bilal went through some difficult times and no one can say that he was bad. If you're trying to say that I am bad. But anyway, the point here is that it is the norm that that is going to happen. Nobody can guarantee that he or she won't go through any difficult times. You know, Sayyidina Muhammad himself has been stoned. Does that indicate anything bad about Sayyidina Muhammad? No. No. You know, somebody could fall and then they have a broken arm, broken leg. As long as you say, Ya Allah, I accept this. Ya Allah, heal me. Ya Allah, cure me. This acceptance will make things easy. Imagine if you complain about everything in your life. You won't be happy. So as long as the crisis is not in your deen, then you say Alhamdulillah. Second, you would say Alhamdulillah that this crisis which occurred in your life, right, wasn't bigger than it is now. Like now, someone lost his sight. Well, may Allah forbid this. If once lost his sight, how he or she is going to just deal with this? The right way is to say that Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. The one who gave me the sight is Allah. And now it has been taken away. And I shouldn't have doubt about the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why is that? Because Allah knows and I don't know. Why is that? Because secondly, Allah might give you whatever you want by preventing you from what you want. What is that again? Allah might give you what you want by preventing you from what you have asked. So you might ask Allah, Ya Allah, I need this. And you insist. And then Allah doesn't give you what you are after. Because He knows it's not going to work for you. It's not going to make you a happy person. Why? Because Allah knows what has happened, what is happening, what would happen, which has never been happening. If it happens, how would it be like? This is Allah's knowledge. Allah is the all-knowing, all-hearing, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows everything. So you need to trust Him. Number three, you say Alhamdulillah, the crisis has taken place, but you say Alhamdulillah, because Allah gave me sabr. And Allah enabled me to make dua. Allah gave me sabr and enabled me to make dua. What is sabr? Patience, perseverance. You are able to carry on. You are trusting Allah. You are trusting Allah that what happened in your life happened for a reason. You know, like a sister cannot find the right husband. Trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is happening for a reason. A brother or a sister, they are married, but they don't have kids. And they've tried. And they have tried many times, but they don't have kids. It's not working. That could be the best for you. You never know. Or it could be the best for you to get get kids but not now, after 5 years of marriage or 10 years, but not now. Or you get a kid and this kid dies. And then you feel very bad. We all feel bad for that. Even we believe that we are going to be reunited in the day of Qiyamah in Jannah, but because of that separation, we feel bad. If one's mom dies, that person would feel bad, will feel quite bad and sad. But again, even though we believe that we are going to be reunited with our own moms after they die, and after we die in Jannah, inshallah. But we have to remember that this is a test from Allah, and we have to have the sabr. And this sabr or patience is a gift from Allah. There was a lady who lost someone, and she was by the grave. Sayyidina Muhammad was passing by, and she was crying. Then Sayyidina Muhammad tried to make it easy for her and tell her about sabr and stuff. She said, إِلَيْكَ عَنِّي, stay away from me. You are not experiencing what I am experiencing. So you might be telling me, have sabr because you don't have my problem. Sayyidina Muhammad nicely and kindly left. Then she came to know that that was Rasulullah. So she came rushing after him saying, please forgive me. I didn't know that it was you. Now I seek Allah's forgiveness and stuff. He said to her, إِنَّمَا الصَّبْرُ عِنْدَ الصَّدْمَةِ الْأُولَى. Indeed, patience and perseverance is when the first shock happens. The first shock happens, you don't say something complaining about Allah's decision, Allah's fate, Allah's destiny. Someone died, you cry. Yeah, you would cry. We are human. You would feel sad, yes. But never say, never complain that Allah has done this to you. It was an amana, and the amana's time came. It was a trust amana, and it has been taken now. Don't complain. You feel sad, it is your right. Sayyidina Muhammad, when his own son Ibrahim died, he said, إِنَّ الْعَيْنَ لَتَدْمَى. Indeed, I would have tears. وَإِنَّ الْقَلْبَ لَيَحْزَنْ. And indeed, my heart is saddened. وَلَكِنْ لَا نَقُولُ إِلَّا مَا يُرْضِي رَبَّنَا. وَإِنَّ عَلَى فِرَاقِكَ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ لَمَحْزُنُونَ. And I am indeed Ibrahim. He's talking to his son, whom he's burying. And indeed, Ibrahim, I am very sad for your death. But I will never say anything. Make Allah angry with me. I won't complain. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken you, and I accept that. So this is a gift that you have been given sabr when the crisis occurred. Number four, what makes it easy for you to accept the crisis is that it was Allah's choice for you. And you say to yourself, Allah's choice is better than mine. Allah's choice is better than mine. He's choosing for me. Let me trust him. You know, when you are a baby, right, or a child, don't you trust your own dad? 2 or 3 years old, maybe 7 years old, you won't trust him that much. Or mom, you start to complain, you have your own decisions, and you start to argue. But when you are 3 years old, don't you trust dad? You have the big problem, the big crisis in front of you. You are okay. Why? Because you're holding the hand of your dad or holding mom's hand. Allah is taking care of you. You don't trust him? You trust your dad and mom. You don't trust Allah? Allah is the one who gave you mom and dad. Allah is your creator. Allah is your Rabb. Allah is Al-Wadud, the one who loves you. Allah, who is actually, is the one who is making you to enjoy things by creating beautiful things for you. He didn't create only food and stuff, but he created as well beautiful flowers. Do you think that if we don't have flowers in the world, it would be difficult to live? No, we can live without flowers. Why Allah created flowers? Because he loves us. He wants us to enjoy things through our own sight, when we smell it, through the different senses we have. And that is a reflection of the name Al-Wadud, the one who loves his creation. The one who loves his creation is Allah Al-Wadud. So it is the Allah's choice for you. That's why in the day of Qiyamah, was reported, some people will get out of their graveyards, go into Ard al-Mahshar, and they will go straight to Jannah. Ridwan would say, hey, where are you going? Come on, take it easy. Where are you going? We're going to Jannah. They would say, going to Jannah? You're not standing for accountability, for scale, to weight your a'mal, your deeds and stuff? You're just going straight to Jannah? Say, yeah, we are. They said, no, we don't stop for accountability, nor we wait for our deeds to be weighed. We go straight to Jannah. He says, who are you? They say, we are the people of sabr. We نحن أهل الصبر. Haven't you heard in the Quran, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Indeed, those who have had patience would indeed be rewarded without limits. So imagine you are among those people. Number five, it is Allah's fate and destiny. The bala, the trial, the tribulations is Allah's destiny. But that shouldn't stop you from making dua to that Allah make it easy for you. You are supposed to make dua always when the bala occurs as a way to calm yourself down. And that's why when people come and give you condolences in Islam, it's a way of supporting you. But the main support is not actually those people. The main support for you is your strong faith in your heart. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with you and Allah would support you. And Allah is enough with you, for you. When you say, Hasbunallahu wa ni'mal wakeel. You know the verse which is talking about bala in the Quran and trials and tribulations. It starts with, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ista'inu bis sabri was salah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Oh, whom you believe, seek help in sabr, patience, perseverance, and salah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Indeed, Allah is with those who are patient. And then after another ayah, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ. It is normal that you are going to go through trials and tests. Some people, they struggle. They don't have even the food, as I've mentioned. Some people, they struggle and they get saddened because one member of the family has died. Imagine if that person who have died is a son, or a father, or a mother, or a husband, or a wife, or a daughter. It is not easy. When we were in Jordan, actually, it was an experience. We were touched by the strength of those people from Syria and Palestine. They lost many things. They lost many, many things. Forget the homes and money. And they lost their own beloved ones. But we were touched, especially in a city called Erbid, by some Syrian kids. They were very strong, smiling, hoping that things are going to change. We have had a chat with them and we say, and what do you want to be when you grow up? One said, one of our daughters, a girl, 10 years old girl, she said, I want to be a lawyer. Indeed, she would. Was very well spoken, very smart and intelligent. In another place with those trials and need, subhanAllah, and we went with some help and aid, so they have been given some blankets and clothes and some cash. We have had some interaction with Muhammad from Damascus and his sister Noor. Beautiful voices. Then you try to give him 10 pounds, 20 pounds. He doesn't take it from you. He needs it. I know that he needs it. But look the way of tarbiyah. How he has been raised. He doesn't take anything from anyone. He looked at his mom. His mom didn't give any signal. He didn't take the money, nor even Noor. Noor is about 8 years old, 7 years old. No way. Wallahi, they need the 10, 20 pounds. I am sure that we are going to make their week by giving them 20 pounds. But till I took the money, and many brothers and sisters, may Allah reward them, give me more money to Muhammad and Nur, because they have given, they stood on the stage and gave such beautiful nasheeds, so we wanted to support them. And I chucked the money into her hand. She wasn't actually, she didn't want to take it, but she took it. You know that feeling? And again, I thought, what if my wife was one of those standing in the line waiting for a blanket? Ya Allah, I will die many times. If my wife and my kids waiting in a line, I wasn't actually thinking about those people only. I was reflecting over my own life and how I am supposed to thank Allah. And the trials I'm going through, I should look at it in a more positive way, not in a negative way. I say, Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah that I am better than many people in the world. Imagine, may Allah forbid this, my brothers and sisters, imagine that you are standing in a line waiting for a blanket or a jacket or a coat because of the cold. Imagine if you're not sure about tomorrow's meal. You could actually carry on because you are an adult. If you have kids, how would you feel if the kids cannot get their own food? How would you feel? You would be ready to cut from your own flesh and feed them, won't you? What beautiful gifts we are enjoying, but in most cases, we are not appreciating because we don't reflect. It becomes guaranteed for us. It becomes the norm. Ibtila or trials is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah could test you with good stuff or bad stuff, as I've mentioned. Someone could be given millions of dollars and that person would just treat it as amana. I know someone have got millions of dollars, right? And he, may Allah reward him, is helping us back in New Zealand by paying all the rent and even paying a staff, one staff member, and power and stuff for the new Muslim project, Auckland, New Zealand. But not only this, he had his own family, big family, and some of those families are poor. So who would give those orphans and needy from within his family first some salaries. And this is what you're supposed to do. Before giving away any money, look at your own family. If you have family back home and they are needy, give them. If you have extra, give others. This is how you appreciate Allah's gift, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, there are many benefits for the difficulty and crisis we go through. One of them is that Allah removes away the bad deeds from our files. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that even the sorrow and sadness washes away one's bad deeds. Even if a brick, you know, get into your feet and you take it out, you just aim that Allah would give you a reward for this. Don't look at the crisis as a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't. The crisis happening in your life could be a reason for you to be elevated in ranks in Jannah. You are supposed to go to level number 80 in Jannah. But because you were successful in going through that last difficulty and crisis, now you have reached 120. Or now you are able to be in Jannat al-Firdaus. Now you are the neighbor of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Not because of your Hajj. Why? Not because of your Umrah. Why? Not because of your too many nafl salah. Why? Not because of the too much money you have given away to the needy. Why? Because you have been able to accept Allah's qada, Allah's fate and destiny, and you have went through and successfully through difficulties, crises, and bala. So this is how you look at the trials, at the crisis. You don't say, why me? Why me? I am worshipping you, Ya Allah. I am doing salah. I'm giving zakah and sadaqah and you're doing this to me. You might not say that by your tongue, by the way. You could say that by the heart. This is very dangerous. This is very dangerous. If you say that, even by the heart, that means that you have a big problem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is rich. Allah doesn't need me nor you. When Allah created in this life, it is for our own happiness. Who chooses what way to be going through? It's me and you. We shouldn't blame Allah for anything bad. Again, one of the benefits of crisis in our life or trials and tests is that it strengthens the bond between us and Allah. You know, when you go through some difficulty, you appreciate more what you have. You connect more to Rabbil Alameen. That connection and this strength between you and Allah, you bonding, is a big gift and a big aim you have achieved through your successful achievement, being able to go through this difficulty or crisis. One of the benefits, you remember those who are suffering. Now you lost your job, right? You don't want any benefit from the state. You don't want anything like this. You feel very bad. Because you need to be self-sufficient. And you feel a bit, even though it's you're right, you're being paying tax, now it is the state's responsibility to take care of you, as you have been taking care of many other people, needy people. This is very Islamic system, by the way. But we have failed to achieve this in the modern time, while non-Muslims did like in the West. We have to appreciate that. But at the time of Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Muhammad, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, and especially at time of Sayyidina Umar ibn Abdul Aziz in the Umayyad Khilafat, everyone was able to have enough. Not only that, at the time of Sayyidina Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, if you didn't have time, they came to that stage. Sayyidina Muhammad told the Sahaba that they would reach that stage. They give zakah to people. They say, no, we don't need zakah. We have enough. And according to the ulama, to the scholars, when we give a needy, you don't give a needy 10 pounds. You give a needy enough food for a year. What is that? Enough food for a year. And garments, at least two garments each. One for winter and one for summer. This is the minimum. This is not luxury. This is how Muslims used to live. And this is why Muslims were able to spread Islam, because of justice. Not because they had the sword, not the power. People in Indonesia didn't have fight with Indonesians at all to reach their countries. They accepted Islam because of the good treatings of Muslims, Muslim merchants and business people. Malaysia is the same thing, right? Subhanallah, because of the high moral akhlaq of the Muslims. One other thing which is going to be the benefit of the crisis you go through, that you strengthen your iman in Allah's faith. You strengthen your iman in qada illa Allah. This is Allah's qada. Whether I complain or not, it has happened. So the best thing for me is to accept it and deal with it. And never be negative. Don't say that, oh, I am not achieving because of qada Allah. I am not good because of qada'ullah. I'm not good getting the right husband or wife because of qada'ullah. No. Don't blame Allah. Just look at yourself. Sometimes we're not achieving because we are lazy. So I say to myself that because of my laziness, I'm not able to achieve better. Oh, well, I need to be very practical and objective. Why am I lazy? Why this is happening to me? It's happening to me because of my laziness. Then, okay, I need to deal with this. I need to deal with this. How are you going to deal with the crisis again? Sayyidina Muhammad is reminding us that if you make dua, Because sometimes you say I made dua, but it's not working. You know, I've been making dua for the last 5 years. It's not happening. Never say that. Why? Because Sayyidina Muhammad indicated that if you make dua and you don't get the answer, you will get one of three good things. What are those? Number one, that Allah would fulfill your dua. You want a boy, you want a girl, Allah gave it to you. Allah gave you only girls. You know, sometimes I have three daughters. So when I tell some brothers, when they ask me how many kids do you have, I said three daughters. Say, oh, may Allah make you a boy, give you a boy, you know. Pity, you know. I don't care about your pity. I'm not suffering. I am happy. And I accept that. You know, I'm quite fine with this. But how can you reach that stage where you are fine with this? Imagine if I wasn't able to even have any kids. Imagine if I have had a boy, but he was an idiot and caused me a lot of troubles in my life. Right? I just need to imagine that. Like the story in Surah Al-Kahf. You know, Sayyidina Al-Khidr, when he killed the boy, you know, but Allah showed him that this boy is going to grow up and be like this. And Allah gave him the consent to do that, to teach not only Sayyidina Musa, but to teach all of us. Not Sayyidina Musa. That wasn't only a lesson for Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. This is a lesson for me and you. In the Quran, it is recited, we recite it, and it would be recited till the day of Qiyamah. So, one, Allah would fulfill your dua or supplication. Two, Allah won't fulfill your dua or give what you want, but in return, Allah would take away a crisis which was about to happen, and all was written in Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz. So when you make dua, this is written in Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz. When there was a musibah to happen to you, it was written in Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz. And it was written, when you make dua, it's going to fight with this crisis till the day of Qiyamah between the heaven and the earth. So no problem, it's not going to happen to you. But how Allah removed this from your life? Because of your dua. Because of your dua. Number three, that Allah keeps your dua for you in the day of Qiyamah. Said, Ya Allah, give me richness, make me wealthy. You're not getting this. You are living from hand to mouth. It's not an advice from me to live in that way. No, be as rich as possible. Alhamdulillah, when you're rich, you know, this is good for the Muslims. But my point is that you say that, but it's not happening in your life. Right? Allah, for some reason, kept this for you in the day of Qiyamah. Because Allah knows that in the day of judgment, you would need this help. So the help comes as your acceptance of faith in the dunya. And your dua becomes a support for you in a specific situation. Now you're very thirsty. Because of your dua, the angels are coming to you, taking you very fast to the river of Sayyidina Muhammad Al-Kawthar, and you're not drinking from it. The angels are getting water for you to drink. There are many levels, you know, we are not going to be the same level. Here in dunya, we have different levels in terms of the social class. Some people, in terms of their houses, they have a castle. Others have got a palace. Others have got a townhouse. Other people live in an apartment. Other people live in a tent. Other people are homeless, right? In Akhirah, same thing, subhanAllah. Not all people are going to be the same. But now, Muslims coming to drink from Sayyidina Muhammad River, Al-Kawthar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable all of us to drink from it, inshallah. Ameen. But some of us would go, and by the way, the cups you're drinking from, using to drink from the river, their numbers as the numbers of the stars in our life here. You look at the stars, see how many stars do we have? You would, millions and millions, you would have cubs in the river as the numbers of the stars we have in this dunya. But some people would go and drink themselves. Others would go and the angels would drink, get the water for them to drink. And others will be drinking water from the hands of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Imagine you are drinking water from the hand of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What an honor. And you will never be thirsty after that. You will never be thirsty after that. So your dua comes in the day of Qiyamah to help you. You might say, I've been oppressed all my life. I'm not getting my rights here. Trust Rabbil Alameen. Fight back as much as possible. Forgive as well, if you are able to. But trust Allah and keep making dua. Some of us are very sick. They're very sick since years and years. Remember Sayyidina Ayyub. He was paralyzed. It was said for 18 years. Shaitan came to him to just make fun on him and said, yeah, Ayyub, look at yourself. You're saying that you are the prophet of Allah? You are the Nabi of Allah? Look at yourself, man. Look at yourself. You are paralyzed for 18 years. He said, Shaitan, listen. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told me something. If you know, you would be jealous of me. He said, what is that? He said, Allah revealed to me, ya Ayyub, irda bima qasamta kun aghna an-nas. O Ayyub, accept whatever I have given to you and you will be the richest person on the face of the earth. Irda bima qasamt takun aghna an-nas. Accept whatever Allah has given you, you would be the richest. If you accept what Allah has given you, you won't ask me anything. You don't need anything from me. Allah is enough for you. I've crossed 25 years old or 30 years and I didn't get married. Trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Could be a wisdom behind this, as I've mentioned to you. And that even is not happening to our sisters. It's happening to our brother. Very interesting. It's happening to our sisters as well as to our brothers. They could be having the money, everything is okay, but they're not finding the right person. Trust Allah, make dua. And the dua, I advise you always to make dua as Rasulullah advised me and you while doing sujood. So sujood, you're not praising Allah only in prayer. You are glorifying Allah, but at the same time you are seeking from Him. You are talking to Him. You need to have munajah to Allah. Not only a very formal dua. Outside salah, you could raise your hand in your language. English, French, Urdu, Malay, any language. Allah knows all the language. He's the one who created all. Raise your hand and make munajah. You know what is munajah like? When you are very stressed and you need some support, you call a friend of yours and say, listen, I want to see you very urgently. I feel very sad. Not feeling well. Let's meet up at the coffee house. You meet up and you talk to her from the bottom of your heart that you cry and cry. And she gives you a pat and hugs you and stuff. Or he gives you a pat and hug you and take it easy, man. You're going to be fine. Or the sister say to you, no, you'll be fine. You'll get through this. You need to trust Allah better than this. You talk to him, do munajah, as if you're talking to someone in front of you. You talk to him, you know, in Hajj. Last year, not this year, last year. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enabled me to go to Hajj. On the Mount of Arafat, I saw a sister, I think that she was from Ghana. Wallahi, she was making dua in a very interesting way. I know that there is adab of dua, I understand that. But again, I try to observe and learn. We have to learn all till we die, right? And we need to reflect over things happening around us. Whether this is happening, you know, in the life of human being, animals, plants, keep reflecting. Sister was making dua. She's from Ghana, somewhere in Africa. And she was raising her hand and talking to Allah. Wallahi, I felt that she was able to see Allah. Even though no one can see Allah. But she was talking with the whole body. Not only the tongue, you say dua. No, she was talking in a way that she inspired me. Not only that, but she was on the phone and someone from Ghana was talking to her. And she listens, Ya Allah, يا الله, you know, somebody is telling her, make dua for me about, what is that? I was able to tell, you know, I don't know the language, but it was very obvious. The person in Ghana didn't need to actually do all of this. Allah would hear the voice, whether it is in Ghana or Mecca or Medina or Arafat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all hearing. But because this is a holy place, we have this feeling. But anyway, my point is that to that extent, that lady was trusting Rabbil Alameen. Trusting Allah, that I felt myself that she was honest, she was truthful and sincere. I felt that myself, that she was very sincere. I felt that she was very strong, very strong. And I felt that every word she said, not, even though I never knew, I didn't know anything except Allah only, you know. Allah, Allah, the only word. Apart from this is something, too many things in the list. But she was talking to Rabbil Alameen that manner. I think we need to learn from those situations and talk to Allah sincerely from the bottom of the heart. That's why when you make dua, you don't have doubt that is, if you have doubt that it's not going to be accepted, well, it's not going to be accepted. You have trust, you have your trust in Allah. You have doubt that it's not going to happen? Well, it is not going to happen because you have doubts. Well, you have no doubts but it's not happening? Well, remember the three things. If it could happen, or Allah took away another crisis because of your good dua, or Allah kept your good dua for you in the day of Qiyamah to make your life easier in the day of Qiyamah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our life an easy one. May Allah enable us and empower us with the abilities to deal with the crisis in our life and to deal with the good and the bad. May Allah enable us to raise our kids in the best way. May Allah give my sisters who are looking for good husbands the right ones. May Allah give my brothers the right sister to be a good wife in their life. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our own parents and forgive all Muslims. Before I go, I would like to remind you to always reflect. Remember that trials and hardship is part of our life. It's not a choice. And if we don't have hardship, life is going to be very boring. Accept the challenge. Be positive. Make a change in your life. Don't accuse other people of the problems in your life. Take charge of your life. Be responsible enough to make a positive change. Be objective. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would always be next to you, by you, supporting you. Thank you very much for listening. JazakumAllah khairan.